What's going on? This is the NOC, the Nerds of Color, and we are back with another NOC exclusive. I am Kuya P, aka Patrick Michael Strange, and I am joined by some amazing creators tonight. I have Howard Wong and Josh Stafford of Source Point Press. Let me get the title right. Oh man, I lost the title. I don't want to mess this up. Damned Cursed Children. There we
got
go.
Got to
get that right, because as a parent, sometimes you damn these cursed children, crazy. But before we get into it, my boy Howard, he put these together. He put his marketing hat on. Patrick, throw this in there. And so I'm going to rock with it. Here you go. Check this out. This will give you a little bit of insight before we get down with our conversation. Damned Cursed Children from Source Point Press. My guys, Josh Stafford and Howard Wong. Here we go. There you go. Amazingness. What is this all about? Let's get into it. But before we begin, how are you guys? How are you doing, Howard, Josh?
Good.
I'm doing all right. It was funny. It snowed for like a few days and then all melted away. So it's sort of like we're having a really weird November in Toronto. It's like usually there's snow for, since the beginning of November, but we had like only a few days of snow and sort of like it's nice, and I'm jinxing it now because I'm saying that. But rather than that, everything is pretty cool. It was healthy, staying indoors, doing the whole bit, protecting yourselves from, COVID-19 and all. I don't know. Josh is actually living in a different city. You can talk about that.
Pretty much same weather. We're not too far away from each other, about a 5-hour drive. I'm in Ottawa, but it's getting dark at like 3 o'clock. And it's killing me. Like it was dark. It's just real gloomy and dark at around 3:30. Like needing bike lights at 3:30. And so now it's like 8:30 and it feels like 2:30 in the morning to me now. Like it's just when that gloom hits and it's just dark outside, it just feels like, oh, okay, bedtime. But besides that, everything's okay. But just it's one of those long, dark, dreary winter days today. So
awesome. All right. Well, it's a pleasure to have you guys on, man. And to know what's going on in Canada, which was going to actually still could be my next place of residence, because I was planning if this whole election, I'm here in the States. If this orange guy was reelected, I was going to move. Although I know there's measures in place that, you guys are trying, you don't want us riffraff of us Americans en masse. Because, there's a lot of us. We're afraid, man. We're scared, Thankfully, the election results came out different. But, who knows what's going to happen. So I may still be heading that way. I know my daughter wants to, because last year we were at Niagara Falls. And my daughter fell in love with Canada. And hence, hey, I didn't even think about it.
Ooh, represent. Nice.
Niagara Falls trip. She loves Canada. Loves y'all so much. And she was actually rather upset that we didn't move out there initially.
Whereabouts are you?
Even before the results happened.
Whereabouts are you in the States?
Where am I? I am in the D.C. area.
Ah, cool. Oh, in the heart.
Man, you're exactly. Right there. You're
so
right there.
Politics is 24/7, man. So much love to y'all, man. And it's beautiful. I watch a lot of, who's that guy that fixes houses up there with the bald head? That's Canadian.
Mike Holmes?
Yes. My wife, we're big home network construction type stuff. She loves that stuff. And I am the least of the hammer and chisel kind of guy. I'm a creative guy. So, but yeah, I love Canada. So love y'all for coming on. Anyway, whole tangent there, but appreciate y'all for coming on. So let's talk about, this is going to be a little bit different for those that watch my interviews. I generally kind of go into each individual's paths, but I want to know how this relationship started. How did y'all come together before we lead into the project and talk all about that? Just talk about, getting into comics and how your paths crossed, whoever wants to kick it off.
Josh, you want to start this one off?
Yeah, we met, it couldn't have been nerdier. We met at San Diego Comic-Con, where I was there. I directed a short film. I directed a few short films. And in the very 11th hour, it got accepted into the San Diego Comic-Con Film Fest. So a friend of ours, did you know Tom at the time? Or
no, Tom Fowler. So what happened was I was there at San Diego Comic-Con with Image because I had a new book out after The Cape, my first published work anyways. And I was looking for a place to hang out and stay. And I met Tom Fowler. No, I didn't meet Tom. That's the first time I met Tom. I actually met Attila Artojani, I think the same week. Literally the same week.
I didn't realize that. Wow.
And I bumped into them at San Diego because there was some kind of, I had an issue where I was staying. And they were listening to my stories. And then he asked, and like the next day, Tom's like, you want to stay with us? I'm like, where are you guys staying? In a condo. It's small, but it's nice. I walk in, it's like, holy crap, there's space, and it's only three of us? Yes, I'm staying. And then Tom pointed to the walk-in closet where I would be sleeping. I literally slept in the walk-in closet for San Diego Comic-Con. The life. And that's why I met Josh. Josh came in a few days, I think on the third day or the second day. I can't remember which day you came in San Diego Comic-Con. And you were like this giant-ass backpack, this nerd backpack on your back. And then Tom's like, hey, Josh, Howard, staying with us now, sleeping in my closet. And Josh is like, so I still get the couch. I'm like, there was a couch? And then Josh asked me what I did. And I'm like, well, I read a book called After the Cave. Really? He dropped down his back and whipped out a copy.
I had just bought it just because I thought it looked cool. And then, then I was roommating with one of the writers or the writer of it. So yeah, we met just in the trenches of San Diego Comic-Con, which anybody who's been there, it's almost indescribable. And just from what I understand, the decade since we've been there is just tiptoeing to bigger. But we were lucky that the place we were staying was within walking distance of it. So it was just this little condo. Our friend Tom, I went to high school with Tom and still friends with him. And he's drawn everything from Green Arrow to Star Wars stuff. He was working on the Sandman universe stuff. That was his last gig. But yeah, so that's where I met Howard. It was at San Diego Comic-Con. And
I love that condo though. That condo was on ground floor.
Oh yeah, it was great.
It was great because it was close to the convention hall. But the best part was where Josh was sleeping, which was the living room / kitchen area. The main window of the living room looked directly into Starbucks, where everybody from Starbucks can see directly into the condo, which I didn't know, by the way. So I walked around in my underwear. So that was fun. the first day, like, is those people? That's not a TV. Oh, shit. And I had to run back. And anyway, I was like, yeah, but don't open the window until you have clothes on. I was like, thanks. but the funniest part was I saw many, many creators drinking coffee or buying coffee there. So it was like a mini San Diego Comic-Con, but from the comfort of where I was staying. So I saw like Rob Liefeld having his coffee and I waved hi to him. I was making my coffee for free and stuff like that. It was the most bizarre place to be. But Josh was there. So because of Josh was staying with us, I got to talk with them and hang out with them. And oh man, there's so many wicked stories too. Like I think I was trying to have lunch with Josh one day. I forgot which day it was. Was it the last day at Comic-Con? I can't remember. But I thought I had some time off from the booth, and I didn't. I was like trying to text Josh. I'm like, I'm sorry, I can't make the lunch. And I put some meetup somewhere close to the heavy metal booth, but I couldn't reach him, and I couldn't like leave the table. So then Josh came back hours later, and I felt so bad, and he shoved this book at me. Let's see, I should have it. I purposely had it out. So he shoved this at my face.
Oh, got it.
And I was like, I'm like, what's this for? And I don't know if you can actually read this, but I'll read it out loud. This is Howard Bleep Love Biz. So I'm like, oh, this is awesome. Like in my, so I'm in the, you know, image booth looking it up, laughing my ass off, and Josh starts walking away. I'm like, wait, no, I'm so sorry. What happened to you? So Josh can tell the story of what happened to him as he was waiting and being dumped by me, unfortunately, by accident.
Well, if you ever go to Comic-Con, you have to miss three cool things to do a cool thing. Like there's never an empty point on the schedule. And I remember days where I skipped going to see one comic panel I wanted to because there was a movie I wanted to see that had, you know, something, or going for Bruce Campbell autograph and missing somebody else's autograph. So when I missed hanging out with Howard, I just walked away, and I'm a big old school Ninja Turtle fan. And I'm at the exact right age to be a Simon Beasley Lobo fan. Like that happened when I was in like grade 9 or so. So I love that stuff. And so I went to the heavy metal booth, because at the time that's where Kevin Eastman was like the publisher of. And there was a nice lady there. And I just said, oh, are they going to be back for doing autographs and stuff? And she said, Kevin's somewhere else. And Bees should be right back. And he was. And I started chatting with him, and he looks like Lobo. Like he looks exactly like him. And we chatted a bit, and then he said he wanted to go for a smoke. And I laughed, and I said, I never wished more that I smoke than right now. And he laughed, and he said, oh, come out, we'll have a chat. So I followed him out of the con, and he's enormous, and people are just like getting out of his way. And he's shaking hands and saying hi to people. Like you could tell he's probably been there once a year for 20 years or something. So we go outside, he has a smoke, we chat for a bit, and then he goes, I can go for a drink. Do you want to go for a drink? And then he laughs because I also don't drink. So I go with him anyhow. We go to this nearby hotel bar, and he buys me a Coke, and he has a couple beers. And I find the key to meeting a fellow nerd, no matter how famous they are, is, you know, don't ask him about specifics or what happened in this issue or that. So we talked about Canada. I was wearing a Ramon shirt, and I just remember that because we talked about the Ramones, talked about his hometown and my hometown. And then next thing you know, I'm sitting at a bar with him for 2 hours, probably. We're going back in, and he says, using the British term, he says, oh, you have a rucksack on. And I go, yeah. And he goes, hey mate, do you want to smuggle in some beer for me? So we go to like the nearby, there's like a little 7-Eleven or something right near the hotel convention center. And he puts 6 beers in my backpack. We walk back in. He gets to his table. He kind of looks over his shoulder, takes the beers, puts them down. And I ask if I could buy a book off of him. He looks over his shoulder, because if anybody's ever gotten an autograph from somebody, or like, you know, often it's not the creator, but the handler who hinders you from getting that extra time or that free photo or whatever. So he looks around, there's nobody to like chaperone him. He grabs a giant stack of heavy metal hardcovers and books and slides them over, autographs them all for me, draws Lobo in one of them just with like a Sharpie, and draws it just like a madman, like just draws Lobo down. And then I told him that I got stood up by Howard, and that's how I got to the fates made me have beer with him. And so then he grabbed a book at random, and he put F.U. Howard and wrote it in there. And that was it. And so I had this lovely interaction with Simon Beasley, that one in a million. So it's like that silver lining, like, oh, missed lunch with Howard, but got to hang out with Simon Beasley. that was my greatest story that year, I think.
Awesome. So I love con stories, man. This is fantastic. Yeah. Beautiful.
So that's how we met. I actually met Biz afterwards, and I got a sketch of Lobo from him. And Biz is a big guy, and I told him that after he did finish the sketch of Lobo for me, I'm like, oh, by the way, I'm that Howard that ditched Josh. He's like, he looked at me, he's like, fuck you. I'm like, I know. I walked away after that, which was awesome. he's like the nicest guy. He's like the biggest guy you ever see. And he's like hilarious. But that's how I met Josh. So I met him like the biggest nerd, you know, way possible. We became friends because we basically hung out like after the, like, it's not during the convention because I'm busy because I'm actually there, you know, marketing my book and helping out the image booth. So it's always like at night when we hang out. So we would bump into each other at bars and whatnot. And we just literally nerded out about stuff. And we just sort of connected with the things that we liked. And then we basically kept in contact. Those he lived in a different city. You know, he would come over for the conventions in Toronto at Fan Expo. And then sometimes he'll be my table helper so he can walk around and leave me at my table. And
bring you back burgers.
Like that. He brought me back food. Con food is gross, but he did bring me back food, which was very nice. It was very appreciative. But then what ended up happening? The way the story came. So Damn Cursed Children. Where that came about, which is a hilarious story, I guess, in a way. My kids were very young at this time, and they were going to daycare. And for whatever reason, they brought back the plague every week. My wife and I were so sick of being sick during that time. Like, the doctor wouldn't give us antibiotics anymore because we were taking it to the point where he's like, I can't give you anymore. Because any more than you, I must as well just send you to the hospital. I'm like, seriously? Is it that bad? We're going to die? He's like, no. You just got to get through this and stop getting sick. I'm like, yeah, we just want to get sick every day. So Josh called me one day during a time when I was the one who was like super sick and I was bed dying. My wife was like half dying. So she's the one taking care of the kids and everything. And Josh is like, are you sick again? I'm like, I'm still sick from last week, but I'm sicker this week. and then Josh blurts out, Damn Cursed Children. I'm like, and my sick, drug-infused brain thought, hey, that's a great title for a book. And Josh is like, you should use it. You should write a story. I'm like, yeah, it'd be a horror book with kids in it. Hey, you want to write it with me? And Josh is like, oh, yeah, sure. I'm like, okay. And then I think we banged out a I'll be honest, I don't remember if it was a good plot or a shitty plot because I was like, out of my mind. I thought it was the greatest shit ever, by the way. But at the end, I was like, okay, I gotta go because the menace is kicking in. I'm gonna pass out. And I remember that was the last time I talked to Josh at that point. And Josh was working his ass off on it. And then we would go back and forth. So we were changing the plot back and forth. And we started scripting it. At that time, I was finishing up after the Cape 2. Which is the follow-up miniseries from the first series at Image. And one of the artists I tried to get on that book, he was greenlit to do it, totally in it, but then he had a kid, so his wife said no. so he couldn't do it. But I kept in contact with him, going, I really love your art, man. I'm gonna find something to, you know, to do with you. And then I'm like, hey, do you want to do this? And I sent him the script and everything, which was Damn Cursed Kids, Children. And he's like, yes, I want to do it. I'm like, great. And you start drawing it. But then, you know, life happened. You know, I had stuff to do and other books and work. And then the artist's name is Robin Simon Ng. He's from Singapore, Singaporean. Shout out to Singapore. I love that place. seriously, man, you guys, your hawker markets, your food hawker markets, bring them, share them around the world, please, man. Holy cow. So he was drawing that, and then he had a second kid. He's like, I can't work on this right now, blah, blah, blah. So it took a long time for him to do it. And I kept him pitching it. And Josh and Robin is like, so to get in, who'd you talk to? And I won't name publishers or editors. The comments we were getting were all positive. So it's sort of like, wow, I love this. This is so old school. This is great. We can't publish this. I'm like, what? Does it make you love it? You like it, but you don't want to do it. Okay, tell me why. I know you well enough that you can tell me why, and you know I won't get mad. I'm not that kind of person. And you tell me why. I'm like, okay, I get it. I get it because of the content. It's a little over that border that what you would do. Fine. You know, beyond your parameters, which is fine. Every publisher has a certain set of parameters that they work with, right? So we went from publisher to publisher. I had meetings with editors. It's always the same thing. Like, oh, I love this. When it comes out, let me know. It's like, great. Yeah. That's wonderful. And then I was thinking about doing Kickstarter for a bit. And then I was talking to friends who were doing Kickstarter. And for whatever reason, the few friends I did talk to who did Kickstarter, Bless Their Souls, you know, I thought they did, you know, did great work. It was successful online. Dude, I just broke even. Oh, dude. I owe people money. I'm like, no, I'm not doing this because I have kids. I don't think I should do this. If you are a single person who has totally focused on this, messed up, oh my God, no, I got to really think about, I got to make a plan before I do a Kickstarter. So haven't done one yet, still researching. So I was like looking for a publisher to do it with. And I went to one of these after con parties in Toronto. Just to see, you know, honestly, to hang out with friends. I wasn't there to network or anything. I was just hanging out with friends. So I wasn't with anything. I was just me and my, you know, my sandals. I wear sandals at cons, go for the vehicles. I sit and walk around a lot. So, yeah. And I'm like, my sandals going, whatever. I'm just going to kick it and just chill and eat, you know, whatever. And then a friend's like, you got to meet this guy. I'm like, sure. And it's like, who's this? This is Travis. I'm like, oh, hey, Travis, what do you do? So, I'm the founder of, blah, blah, blah. You know, it can be a long title. Source Point Press. I'm like, oh, you're a publisher. It's like, yeah. Oh, shit. We started talking. Honestly, I was like pitching. Right? We're just talking about the industry and stuff like that and other things. And then he's like, you need a pitch? I'm like, I have things that people don't want. Do you want to hear that? It's a joke, obviously. And I literally talked about Damn Cursed Children. It's like, I'll do it. Like, you're serious? Like, I just told you why people didn't want to do it. It's like, we'll do it. Fuck it. We'll do it. So I'm like, wait. Is this like BarCon talking or is this like, you know, real deal? So I'm like, okay, once I email you after the convention and you're still cool with it, you know, send contracts, we'll talk. We did. And then so this is like a couple of years after we finished everything. I'm like, I emailed Josh and Robin, like, so this publisher is actually wanting to publish this. They're like, what? Damn Trick Children? I'm like, yeah, seriously? I'm like, they know what it's about. I'm like, yeah. You send a preview page, like, yes, I sent them the art. You know exactly what they're getting into. I explained multiple times why people were kind of afraid to publish it. It's like, okay, then let's do it. I'm like, we're in? Good. So we got in, we signed a contract, and then we're doing it. And as we're like sending like additional pages, because Robin was reworking some of the pages, it's been years, right? I was getting feedback from their art director, from the publisher, EIC. It's like, oh, this is gruesome. Oh my God, this is awesome. I'm like, you guys get this, right? It's like, oh, this is great. I'm like, we're in good hands. That's cool. Because if you say, oh, can you like tone it down a bit? You know, it's a little too far. Then I would have known like, oh, we signed the wrong contract. But they didn't. We're totally like, keep going, go further. I'm like, are you sure? Because even I'm a little like, I don't know. Did we go too far here? I'm like, I'm that guy. Every time Josh would write a scene, I'm like, did we go too far with this? Because I know I was happy when I helped add more. I'm like, did we go too far? Seeing the art now, I'm like, it looks like it's too far. And Josh, like, no, it's great. Yeah, but you just crank that, you know, that little guy and the, okay, well, if you're okay with it and Robin's okay with it, that's 2 out of 3. So I guess I should be okay with it too. And then it turned out to be a great scene and stuff like that in the first issue. It set the tone and I was like, yeah, after that, the leap of faith is just, you're all there. And I'm like, yeah, I was just like, cause you know, I'm like, do I want to go this far? Should I go this far? And then Josh would remind me like, remember all the horror comic books you read? I'm like, and the you know, creeper shows and stuff you watch, and you know, Twilight Zone stuff. I'm like, yeah, wasn't that too far? I'm like, yeah, that's true. And I grew up totally okay, sort of. So why not? So the way we worked, though, it was crazy. For me and Josh, I mentioned that because when we send stuff back and forth, we would change things like dramatically. Sometimes Josh would just delete everything I write, and I would do the same thing back and forth. But then people was like, do you guys like hate each other? Do you like flip tables or, you know, drive to Ottawa and have a fight? It's like that. Drive 5 hours to punch him in the face or vice versa. I'm like, no, maybe give me, I don't know, because we're very Canadian about it, but we're like, so what do you think of this? If I make these changes here, you don't have to change it, but what do you think of this? And then I would read them like, that's actually a lot better. Like, yeah, we'll do that.
Well, but then sometimes, like yesterday, Howard noticed something in one of the pages, just a little word balloon thing that he thought he had switched but didn't. Mm-hmm. The smallest little thing. And he sent it over and he goes, oh, should we switch this and switch that? And I said, no, the wording is fine. And it's one of the characters yelling like freaking get the hell out of here, something like that. And it sounded a little weird, but I said it in my head. I'm like, no, I think that sounds good. And I said, but I would change goddamn into two words, like the most finicky of things. Yeah. And that's like our whole writing style. And I said, like, if we ever stumble into getting like one of those like crazy $200 absolute edition hardcovers of Damn Cursed Children with like the script inside, the script's unreadable because it started all nice, but it's gone back and forth like to draft number 50 with like blue text and orange text and things crossed out. But because we're both like laid back and go back and forth, like there was never a time where I was like, if you make this character say that, I'm out of the project. Like that never happened. And what I love about the miracle of modern technology and working on something like this is like, there was a point where Howard was much further than Toronto. Howard moved far, far, far away. So Howard and I were far away. And then our artist was far away. We're in three different countries, different time zones, and just sending drafts back and forth. So sometimes there'd be like hours between a reply because I would be asleep because it would be, you know, 1 a.m. Ottawa time. But it's very interesting because once upon a time, it would have been all of us in a room together, like the old Marvel method, right? Like it's like office work. But now it's fascinating that everybody's so far away from each other. And then like Source Point Press is in Michigan. So that's right. So that's like a fourth point on the globe to attach to Damn Cursed Children now. So it's a very interesting modern way to work, but it's exciting. Like Howard said, like this took years. And if anything, from our little success story here is like, don't give up. It'll happen because everything I've had, this is a horrible year for our planet. And I hate to make light of it. But I've had a very good year because I have a short story right now. It just came out in an anthology called Flip Volume 2 from Maricosa Press. It's a British company. So I got that come out. I'm working on a new issue of my little independent book called Zomkeys, which is like a fun zombie monkey book. So the fourth issue of that is about half done. And I stumbled into getting a story credit on this really awesome cartoon called DC Superhero Girls because a couple of friends of mine are working on it. And I pitched them some ideas and one managed to get through. So, and then Damn Cursed Children, which I love. So I've got I'm just a comic nerd, and the thought of having my name in a comic book is amazing. And this year I got to write a Flash cartoon, which is nuts. And so Damn Cursed Children took forever, but now just seeing it come together. And I was so proud of my wife, who's a nerd in her own right, but not a lifelong nerd that I am. And I showed her, Howard sent me like a text of the previews page for Damn Cursed Children number one. And I kind of showed that to her and she got all excited and like choked up because she was like, oh my God, this book is in previews. She didn't realize this was like an actual published book because my last book was kind of like self-published and real like in the trenches. So it's just great. Like and Source Point Press have been so good. And now we've got this awesome, scary kid comic coming out. And then we get to talk about it for the next 5 or 6 months or longer. So it's great.
Oh man, I love this. I love this kind of back production type stories. Like you the con stories, man, you know, I having been involved with this as long as well, you miss those con stories and then to get this behind the scenes production of how it came together. And again, sticking with it, you believed in the source, in the material and it happening. So congratulations to you both. So I want to go back to where it kind of came together off of three words, Damned Cursed Children. How
it's amazing. Yeah.
Yeah. How like, okay, that was the title, but then the story that led from that, like, did you know you wanted to, I don't know if this is like zombie stuff or if it's just sick kids, children from corn. Actually, let's take it back to your horror background in a way, like, and then to then where you took and conceptualized that phrase, Damn Cursed Children, into the story that it eventually became, without giving away too much. I don't want to, again, take away from the story later on that we're going to learn, or if that is a part of that and, you know, in giving, you know, how they became, you know, if that's an element of the story that you don't want to, you know, explain.
I won't give it away, but I will say I love George Romero's zombie movies.
Same. I'm a big zombie guy. Romero's the king.
And like, so doing without taking away anything from our comic book, because I want everyone to buy it and I really like it, is that, you know, you do a story like this and it's nothing new. It's a group of people in a, whether you call it a post-apocalyptic or just like a you know, a terrifying situation, and whether you plop in zombies or aliens or something more realistic, like a plague movie or something like that, like Contagion, you know, which is crazy, but now we're in that. But so you take a bunch of characters, you make interesting characters, and then you put, you just thumbprint in new action scenes or new twists on the characters, or you throw in a type of character who hasn't been in there before, or one who has been, like, kind of, you've got the kid, and you've got the worried parent, and you've got the jerk, and you've got the you know, we have a teacher, so we throw a teacher in the mix and she has to deal with these kids gone crazy. So that's nothing super new, because you could say like, oh yeah, we've seen Night of the Living Dead or we've seen Children of the Corn. But there's just something new to the characters, and there's something new to the surroundings, and we bring different points of view from our dialogue to it. And so I will say that we don't explain everything. It's something terrible happens, but it is definitely, you can see that, oh yeah, this is like, I love Night of the Living Dead. It's just a bunch of people, and then zombies happen, and it's never explained. It's never wrapped up. It's just the end. And so it's you could see that influence for sure. And for me, yeah, I'm a lifelong horror kid. So I don't know. Howard, are you more of a horror kid or a comic nerd kid? I'm everything.
You're everything. Yeah. Well, for horror, my horror background was it's a mix. Part of it was stuff that. Like, I'm a little old school, so you would borrow and rent videos. Obviously, this is like during Blockbuster time, but those all had the vending machines. So vending machines don't have people watching how old you are when you rent them. In the summertime, my friends and I would rent like a stack of horror films, you know, be it from Evil Dead to, you know, Creeper stuff. So I would watch that stuff growing up. Twilight Zone, I love that stuff. But then I also have like the Asian stuff. I mean, if you want to see some crazy, wicked horror movies, Thailand has some of the best in the world. It's absolutely like crazy shit.
If you want to be scared for life, see some of those movies or comics. Oh, yeah, oh my god, some of those horror comics. Yeah,
all comics are all, you have to go then you're looking at, you know, the manga stuff, which is, you know, a whole other thing. But like I mean it just popped in my head, one of my favorite horror films is from Hong Kong. I think I would consider it low budget, I guess. Called Rigor Mortis. It is crazy. It's like it all takes place in one apartment, well, an apartment building, but it's just such a great take on it, because what we call Chinese zombies, right? Chinese vampires. People, you know, some people call them zombies or not. So it's a different version of the zombie / vampire. It's sort of a mixture of the both, but they modernize it and not. And it's hard for me to explain it without giving up too much of the story. So my background's from all of that stuff for horror. For comic books, I started late. I actually like comic books, but I didn't start collecting until, I'll be honest, I was an Image kid. So when Image came out, I was like, ooh, look at the production quality. And then started grabbing that and buying it, and then the long boxes came, and then that went, you know, all that part-time work money went to comics, which was stupid in a way and good in a way and stuff. So my comic background actually came after my horror movie stuff. I'm more of a movie guy and TV series person. TV was my third parent, so, you know, growing up. So I that's my horror background for that. How that translated to Damn Cursed Children. Like Josh mentioned, we wanted to focus on creating the characters so that, yeah, we play on the stereotypical cast here and there, but I really wanted to focus on what would happen if it was really a person in this situation, in this role. What would they do? How would they react? Because I wanted to highlight that, because to me, that's more exciting. If, you know, if you have like some kind of, I know, science expert and you know, I know Navy SEAL, whatever, you know, room, like, okay, we're gonna do this and this and this and get it done, and then, you know, save our butts and get here. Seeing that, done that, it's kind of like not realistic, right? So I literally asked Josh, like, imagine if we were in that situation, you know, if it all, you know, shit went, you know, shit hit the fan, and, you know, kids are coming after you and to you know, eat you. What would you do? So that was the genesis of how we developed the characters and how the story sort of evolved from there. I wanted to focus on that and the journey of the characters. So we have like 5-issue miniseries, and each issue we push the characters forward in the sense of, okay, so this is the first hour or so of, you know, this thing happening. This is, you know, the hour 5, 6 or whatever. Therefore, as you get used to the situation, and that's sort of in quotation, used to it, you have, you know, a more grounding of what you would do to survive, and what, you know, decisions that you make are more, a little more rational. Sometimes they're irrational because you're rationalizing something that before, as in a normal situation, you would never do. But because of this weirdness that's around you, you would say, okay, this is okay because this is really messed up. I'm going to do this now. And that's what's going to happen. So we focused on that to generate this story and the characters. We took bits and pieces from all the films and shows that we liked, because Josh would go, hey, why don't we do this? Because, you know, reminds me of X film and X thing. I'm like, yeah, right. We'll do that. But we're going to add this too to it. And then this way, sort of like a mixture of things to pay homage to a lot of things. If you look at our covers, they're all homages, like completely. Like, we know that we did it purposely because we're like literally picking movie posters and comic book covers and sending them to poor Robin in Singapore. Because when we asked Robin, it's like, hey, do you like these stuff? Have you ever watched these? Like, we literally get, I mean, between me and Josh, this was the longest, one of the longest emails. We gave him a list of films and like just barrage of EC comic book covers to him. Like, have you read this? Have you seen this? Have you watched this? And Robin's like, nope, 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 nope. Like,
I think Robin might be the most non-nerd comic artist I've ever heard of. I don't know what his nerd factor is, but he hasn't heard of anything. We introduced him to all of it.
And it was like an info dump for him. And I felt kind of bad. And I end up like, do you want me to give you a call? Just, you know, because I feel kind of bad because this email is like 20 pages long now. It feels kind of bad. Because we like, we wanted these kind of covers. We wanted to do this like in this style. And it's like, are you sure? Yes. we know what we're doing. Just listen, draw it, damn it. But I asked him if they wanted me to call him and explain why. And it's like, oh, no, it's cool. I get why you're doing it, because it's a homage. I'm like, yeah, just draw it like the, you know, draw it in your style. And if you don't understand it, watch the films, not with your kids. Please don't watch it with your kids. Because kids are really young. So, you know, it was really weird because from that email, I was literally learning more about Josh's horror background from that email, because of all the stuff he was listing out. And I was listing out the same, like, yeah, those films. And also these films, I'm like trying to find like Asian films, and I'm popping down the movie posters, and I'm like, don't draw this, but this is just inspiration. Follow this, you know, follow the comic book ones, because we're going to do that because people would get that. So it was really weird for us to do that, because we literally nerded out on that email, I think. And then Robin was like saying, nope, haven't seen it, sorry, no. It's just one line letter each reply. But that's how we did the covers and stuff too. But inside, just for everybody to know, it's a black and white comic, not colored. And the reason why we chose to do that was to pay homage to the EC comics back in the day.
More like the Marvel like oversized, yeah, yeah, black and white, like Tomb of Dracula and the early Blades. And Robin's artwork looks so like from the like 1973. Like, it looks like it should be in one of those, like, it looks so good. And so it's one of those things, like, I don't want it colored. I really like it. It wasn't just to save us money and time. It was actually a artistic choice to leave it black and white.
Just for you guys to know, the person who colored all the covers was Robin. So Robin technically could color all the pages. Mm-hmm. So he asked repeatedly, should I color this? And we debated for a bit for about that. I remember you guys debating about it. I even talked to the publisher at Source Point Press. I'm like, hey, we can color this if you think it would be better for us to color this. And then we explained why we didn't want in color. And he's like, nope, doing black and white. I'm like, okay. So, you know, Robin was like raring to go to color it. Like, I can color this. It's going to look great. I'm like, no, don't color it. And I was like, yeah, don't do more work. It's cool. We're going to do it this way. And it was weird because and every time we talk and discuss and have meetings, and our meetings is usually on like either through email if we're involving Robin, or when we talk, we just do on Facebook. We literally end up nerding out over things as to our decision making is basically which is the biggest nerd about this. Okay, that's the way we're going. Fine, decision is made. So it's always been positive. We never had an argument. I don't think we ever said, this is a stupid idea. This is a dumb thing. This isn't the direction we should go. We never ever had that issue pop up ever, actually, which is kind of awesome. Because I've worked with other like companies to people and teams and stuff on other projects that not necessarily are my stuff, where it was like you ask a question and you have to go through so many channels to get an answer, but then you never get a definitive answer. And it makes it hard to do what you do. So it hinders your ability to create, to produce a great story. So having someone who can instantly reply and bounce back ideas and justify certain ideas quickly, it helped the process so much. I mean, yes, it took years to make, but when we worked on it, it was never like, oh, I got to work on this. Oh, I don't want to do this. It was never that. It was more like, oh, Josh sent me something. I look forward to working on it. And then, as you mentioned, all the different font colors we use. God, we probably used them all for changes.
Yeah,
it's like I think we had a legend at one point. Like these are Josh's changes, and this is the most up to date. It's this color. This is Howard's changes, and this is color. It's the most up to date one. And at that point, we're like, okay, I'm going to start deleting these things because we're not going to use and go back to them. We're just going to use the latest one because this document now is like way beyond like, you know, five issues. This is crazy. But because of that, it became a really good story, I think. I think more so than we thought, because at first I thought this is going to be one of those great horror books where we have children as the, you know, as the big bad evil. I won't tell you how or why. And then we go on a journey from there, but it just grew and became what it is now, which is, you know, a journey of these cast of characters where, honestly, I love them all. Unfortunately, not all of them are going to make it, but I love them all for who they are and what they do and the decisions that they make in the story. I don't know. It's kind of a weird thing to say that you love your characters, but you know some of them won't make it. But that's how it is with this one.
That's the best compliment is that. So I co-own a movie theater here in Ottawa called the Mayfair, and we jokingly instigated doing a 6-year-long Friday the 13th festival. So we just did part two, and then in August 2021, we'll do part three, and it'll end in 2026. So it's just like a fun thing, an extended festival. So just watch part two. And those movies are just, you know, an excuse to kill some teenagers. Like they're you don't, the characters have nothing. They're just there. But a good horror movie, you know, I remember watching Scream, and when somebody died, you were upset because Wes Craven and Kevin Williamson did such a good job and talk about an unoriginal movie. Like it's just another slasher movie. And so that's like Howard said with this, it's like, I love these characters. And it really is a point where you kill one of them. And it's like, you're like, well, they can't all get out. They can't be like, man, they all survive. Nothing bad happens. That's why anytime somebody gets mad at a movie, especially a movie that like comes back after a lot of years and like they don't like what happened to Luke Skywalker, or they don't like what happened in Blade Runner, they don't like what happened to whatever, they got to realize that bad things have to happen to these characters, because if the new Star Wars movies were just all of our characters sitting around having Thanksgiving dinner, that's not a movie. Like bad stuff has to happen to them, right? So that's like this in a horror comic, it's you got these five great characters and you're like, oh, we're going to get rid of most of them. But that's, I think that goes back to Romero in like this story only it's a day. It's a day in the life of these characters. And in Night of the Living Dead and Dawn of the Dead and those movies, they're all about the same. Like they're not taking place over a long time. And so that's the best thing about the most compliment you can give a horror movie or a horror comic is you're not just watching to see an interesting kill. And in Damn Cursed Children, there's a lot of fun in there. There's a lot of fun action, a lot of fun stuff, but it's got its heavy moments where it's like you've got a couple of the characters are parents and you get a really weird, dark moment where you're coming off this fun scene where it's like kids in a school, in a grade school, and stuff goes crazy and it's kind of fun. And Robin made these like big, cool shots, which is, I like working in comics more than movies, because this movie would have cost $60 million. And we did it for much less than that. We did it for way lower than that. But that's when people don't understand horror. I have friends who are like, I don't understand why you watch horror movies. And you're like, well, it's really good characters and you care about them. And this horrible thing happens, you get out the other side and you're safe. You know, it's, but even going over drafts, right now, like just this year since March, has been really weird, because we wrote this a long time ago, and you hear this from writers or filmmakers or artists all the time. It seems like we might have written this in March. There's just some stuff where somebody who didn't know might go, oh, this is a metaphor for the horrors that are happening right now. And we're like, no, we wrote this years back. But there's a part where they're watching TV and there's lines of dialogue that seems like we could have taken off of CNN and just changed crazy children to a pandemic. That's a weird, creepy thing when you're working in a genre like this, is sadly when something bad happens, you get associated with it. And right now I'm like, wow, there's just a few lines in the book where we're in the books where I'm like, this seems like someone eventually, a year from now, when we have a trade out of this, someone's going to say, oh, so you wrote this in March 2020. And we're like, no, we didn't predict that bad thing.
No, I mean, you know, as Josh mentioned, it's like actually any good horror film, like people who don't understand horror, they look at the gruesome part of it, you know, the scary parts of it. And the reality is, horror fans know about this, but it's every film, a good one, is a social commentary. That's what it is, of the time. And a lot of people miss that. And he's like, oh, it's horror. Oh, so much blood. And oh, this is terrible. It's like, yeah, it's in your face. That's the point. It's to wake you up and go, okay, you question why you find that horrible. Why this happened. As I said, the social commentary, it's a lot of metaphors, a lot of themes in horror films that people unfortunately don't understand or miss or misinterpret, which is actually much worse. And then for us, because we knew that, because Josh and I, that's one of the things that we talked about many, many moons ago, why we connected, because we knew that beyond, you know, the facade of horror, we knew what, you know, the grounding foundation of horror, of a good horror story is, which is that.
Yeah, wow.
So I think we sort of answered the question around and roundabout way.
Man, there's so many things you answered. I had so many questions that you all answered. You guys are coming with it. This has been a very effortless interview for me personally, because you guys are really putting it together. I want to tell you, Robin, Simon, Nig, his art is fantastic. And to hear and the stories that you guys have already explained behind it, and the love, you can see that. I noticed the EC horror and the black and white, and then just the homage on the covers. Fantastic. So you can see that nerd love. So for those that are horror fans and are love comics, you're going to see the love and the appreciation for the material that it's kind of somewhat from through the material. So definitely pick up Damn Cursed Children. This is just fantastic. Amazing, guys. You guys are killing it. I love these stories behind these projects. Just brilliant stuff. And Robin killed it on the art on here. One of the questions are actually, when we first were supposed to do this, we were actually supposed to have done this interview a week or two ago. I can't recall, but due to the COVID times, there was a person that popped in. I had to reschedule with these guys because there was somebody that popped COVID and I had to get tested. And for me, and I'm bringing this up again with you guys as writers and as a, you know, a writer and a host doing this, it was kind of weird to talk about, and you kind of brought it up with what you were saying, Josh, that it could have occurred now with the storyline. With the situation in the world and writing where am I going with this? But like, it was difficult for me to talk and in regards to like interview you guys about a horror comic when, in a way, what I was experiencing with, I couldn't believe that with the world and what we're in now, here's this person that popped but didn't really say anything, and I kind of learned in a weird way about it, and I was just so mad with that, and then to talk to, and to just make sure I gave onus and honor to you gentlemen with the horror comic that you wrote, of just how horrifying the world has become and is changing and adapting. And I'm sorry if this is a weird segue, but just as writers yourselves and living in these COVID times and just seeing kind of like humanity right now. And like you said, Josh, how kind of what you with the storyline, they kind of mirroring in a way and just maybe changing a couple of things to subtly would have made it even more ingrained to now, but you wrote this years ago. How is it? And if you were like writing this now and you were kind of, you know, like you said, you probably wouldn't need to make too much changes. It kind of lives in this environment in a way. What are your thoughts on that? And my apologies for kind of like this weird runaround on it. I love the material, but then in a way as writing and as writers, you know, with horror, to me, like humanity now, there isn't any humanity. Like it's crazy. And so it's kind of an escapist in a way, you know, watching horror content now but it's crazy that there's, to me, nothing even more horrifying now with the world the way it is. Yeah, so I'm going to toss that to you guys. Because you guys brilliantly answered pretty much every question I had through the both of you going back and forth, you know, within the past, you know, couple of minutes here that we've done this so far. But yeah, so I'm sorry, guys. Went off on a bit of a tangent, but just writing now in COVID times in horror and all that.
I think, like, anytime, it's very interesting. Anytime something horrible happens, many people seem to think, well, that's it. And I bet you it happened back in World War II. The thing that comes to mind, and it's so horrible to talk about, but I'm a big fan of like late night TV. So like I love David Letterman and the Daily Show and all those shows. So I remember when 9/11 happened, all the TV shows went away. And there was a big thing, and I remember Jon Stewart speaking of it, because he was the host of Daily Show at the time, saying a lot of people were like, well, comedy's done. Like, how can we in New York City as comedians make light of this? But then you look back, and whether it be, you know, silly stuff like Hogan's Heroes or MASH, there's always comedy that comes out of this kind of stuff, or science fiction that comes out of this kind of stuff. Like all of the, you know, Godzilla was because I watched Godzilla recently at the Mayfair. A couple months ago, we had a little mini Godzilla fest, and the first Godzilla movie is not fun. And it's so interesting that it became this real campy, goofy thing. The first one, you watch it and you watch it from the point of view of Japanese people watching that movie. And you're like, and there's shots of them, like the aftermath of Godzilla. It's all the bomb. It's all about the bomb. So you see that culture told a story out of that. And after 9/11, I remember all the comedians saying they were waiting for Letterman to come back. And Letterman came back and did this fantastic show. And then Saturday Night Live came back and comedy continued. And I guarantee you right now, like a few months from now, a year from now, an excellent COVID horror movie is going to come out. Like some kind of Blair Witch shot over Zoom style horror movie. Somebody out there has shot the next, you know, Paranormal Activity or Blair Witch Project. So every time something horrible happens to me, it seems it's telling of humanity. It's a nice thing of humanity is that we keep going, because it just seems that every time something bad happens, we think, oh my God, this is horrible. But you know, something bad happened before and something bad's going to happen again, but we keep on telling these stories. And I think I laugh at, somebody a few years from now is going to do some brilliant university tear apart thesis of damn cursed children in some comic book course and tie in how it's all connected to all the horrible things that happen to kids and guns and how kids have been abused and all this kind of stuff, and tied into our times. We all know the horrible things that have happened at school shootings, stuff you don't want to talk about. It's horrible. but someone's going to write this brilliant thing about our comic, and Howard and I are just going to be like, yes, that is what it was about, you know? So it seems crazy, like, but stories are going to keep getting told about horror and all this kind of horror and comedy are very similar in a strange way. But yeah, so I think, you know, it doesn't seem like it's a creative time, but I bet you there's more stories coming. And I think, like Howard said, like our story took a while to get going. I think I can imagine because of that, like it's a story where there's fun stuff, but it's these little horrible monster gremlin kids. And a lot of them are getting hurt and getting squished and stuff. And you could see some publisher looking at that on the heels of some horrible thing that happened at a school in the States and going, yeah, we can't tell this story. So it's something that we're finally here, and strange that it's happening right now of all the times, but it's going to happen again. Horror will keep going. Horror has been through a lot.
Well, you know, to answer for the question you asked, if we read it now, like Josh mentioned, things keep going. I mean, a lot of creative people, creators, artists, writers, songwriters, what have you, we all share the same, I won't say the word issue, it's not an issue, pause in our process. A lot of people could not do what they do. They could not write or draw or paint or write songs or sing or what have you that you use as a creative outlet, because we were so inundated of, you know, my God, it's a pandemic. The whole world is like shifted, and not in a good way, obviously. I was in that as well for a few moments myself. When I say moments, probably like a month or more than a month or so. And to be frank, I sat down and I wrote in my blog why people should keep creating. And literally, I was writing to myself in a way. And the gist of it was, we stayed home and we watched a lot of Netflix, read comic books, or books that we basically, like any good nerd, we have a big stack of to read books. And that obviously fed us during the beginning of the lockdowns across the world. And the reality was, for me, the reality is, sorry, if anyone stops creating, if we all stop creating, we would not have Netflix shows or podcasts or comic books or whatever you may can, anything you can think of to give us that time away from facing the hardships that we do. It doesn't have to be talking about pandemic. It could be you working three jobs to try to make a living, what have you, whatever your struggle is, you need that pause to reset yourself. Like even when we create, like when I create, I can't go, okay, I'm going to write this book, back to back nonstop every day. I can't do that. I need, you know, like family time, my wife and kids. I need to like watch, you know, shows. I need to listen to some music. I need that pause just to reset myself before I do that. So you always have to create things because, you know, it actually influences and inspires other people to do the same thing. A simple example I gave to some friends who were having a really hard time to continue working creating things was, if the whole world stopped right at this point, no one will draw again. No one will write again. No one will play a musical instrument ever again. This is it. No more. By which generation do you think we would become sad and depressed more so than ever before in any other generation before us? It's quickly you understand that, you know, what you do is important. When you draw something and you share it to the world, it's important because you never know how that would impact somebody, how that would affect somebody. It might inspire a story. Like when Josh mentioned those three words when he called me when I was sick and I felt like I was going to die from the plague. That literally inspired this whole journey that we're on. We're still on. Like we're at the pinnacle of the journey where it's coming out now. Finally, I remember promising Josh, this will get published. I don't know when, but before I die, this is going to happen. and Josh was like, okay, sure. So you got to keep going in that sense. And why it's important for other people. And a lot of people always say, like, this story, like when you write something, it could be, okay, this is another aspect and tangent about it, why you keep creating, especially now and during the pandemic. People are like, oh, the story's been done. I don't have to use my energy to create this story or song or art piece because it's been done. People can just find it, you know, from so-and-so, and then they can enjoy that and be inspired by that. But the reality is, every time you put a word to a page, pencil to paper for art, you know, drop down in music and SoundCloud or whatever, there's always going to be that person's first experience of that genre, that type of story, that journey for them. That's the first thing they ever experience. And it's because you took the effort to do it. After that, their journey will continue. They will go backwards. Go back in time and look at where that genesis came from, and then look forward to other creators too. So it feeds in within itself. And that's important. And when I sort of did that and explained it to myself, I was like, okay, writing comics is not stupid. I should do this. Creating things is not stupid because it will feed into people's imaginations and inspirations and their journey, who knows, into their creativeness. And you know, you never know where that would lead. And at the same time, I had a friend who was great about this. Like, yeah, when I explained it to that friend who was like really depressed, he's like, yeah, actually it makes sense because that younger generation of a creator might make something that we would enjoy. And we get to experience when we're older. So it goes, you know, if we basically, it's like a yin yang thing. Everything feeds into, you know, towards each other, and it creates a balance of, you know, this thing, what we call creativity and an outlet for their creativity. Now, as to how we would deal with the story if we had to write it now today, especially with the pandemic happening and all the crazy stories, well, I would say we would still focus on the same thing, on the human condition, which is basically the first thing that everybody asked themselves, what should we do? Not why, not necessarily why, but what should we do? When the first time the news happened. Now, a lot of us lived through SARS. I have family in Asia, so SARS was very apparent, and I was very aware of what happened during SARS, and here as well in North America. And if you remember, the first thing we did wasn't go, oh, we should wait until we were told what to do. Everybody figured out we should wear a medical mask, and boom, and the N95 mask was sold out everywhere. People wearing them on buses, subways, you name it. You saw people wearing it and still going to work and stuff. So that was the human condition. Now, what happened now? It's weird because we have social media involved, really apparent social media. Everybody has a mobile phone. Everybody from, you know, a child to somebody who's a grandparent. Everybody has a smart device that can access the internet 24/7, live information coming to them. The click of a button. So the human condition to me changed a bit because now we have all these sorts of information, plus what now we have termed fake news to clickbait and what have you, that distracts us from what we should be focusing on. So I would put that into a modern day story of a pandemic kind of theme. The other thing would be probably toilet paper because It sounds funny. I know it's a joke. I was joking. No, the toilet paper thing is a great metaphor. People were driving towards buying as much toilet paper as they can. Did I do that? No, because I always have a couple of, you know, stacks. I have kids, so we go through it. And I'm like, I don't want to keep like filling my trunk full of toilet paper every week. So I buy a bunch when they're on sale and store them. The thing that I bought was food, non-perishables, because I'm like, okay. We went through SARS. We went through a giant blackout back in the day where I think it was like a week, 5 days where we didn't have power across the city. So, you know, you pick up that experiences from there and then apply them to your situation. So a character who is like around my age would know that someone who is younger, maybe, you know, the generation who just, this is the first major incident for them. They would react completely different, right? They would rely on the internet for information. So your character development would be completely different for them. So as I said, we would focus on the human condition, from different generations, their experiences to tell the story. And then the metaphors would be completely different, eh? It would be like, as I said, the toilet paper wars to the lockdowns, to the, and I love this part, the anti-maskers. I don't know how that happened, by the way. That's just absolutely insane and then crazy. Stuff like that. You know, I would feed off on that, show that, but tell the story where there's a social commentary that's underlining all of that. Because if you take a step back, like in, as a, you know, as a person, and look at why are people, you know, running to Costco or Walmart, or whatever, for toilet paper? Why are people why are people refusing to wear a mask? Why are people refusing to lock down? You step back and you see it from their perspective. You try to, at least, because you have an understanding of how all your characters and stories connect. You may not agree with everything. And that's the point of when I worked with Josh, especially for Damn Cursed Children, a lot of the things that I wanted to do and what he wanted to do sometimes did clash because of perspective. When I was like, okay, this father would not probably do this because I probably wouldn't do that too because I have kids and we might want to do that. And Josh would listen, okay, but what if this person was, you know, from this walk of life and this, you know, this is this situation of the person. So when we built their characters and our story for Damn Cursed Children, we did that. We did that walkthrough with each other. Like, we basically used our experiences and our knowledge of who we are and apply them into the story. We do the same thing for our story now. Like, we've been talking about it, actually, for Damn Cursed Children, if we want to do a sequel, and how that would be different because of the situation we were in. We haven't, like, done anything major, but we've been throwing ideas and some stuff for it. And it came up what's happening with outside with the COVID-19 and the world and stuff, because it's like surreal to see the world shut down when it did, and there was no cars on the road around the world, and seeing the footage of empty streets, and then you see the impact on the planet where pollution was down, the ozone was repaired. It was sort of like, you know, wow, this is all the theories that people had. And people didn't care about it. It's like, I still got to go to work. I got to, you know, and the industry's got to go. And you pick up, you see that. It's like, wow, that would be a crazy story to tell if the world locked down and the world healed itself. What would happen then and whatnot? So there's a lot of inspiration from what's happening now and continues to be for stories. It doesn't have to be horror. Like you just mentioned, there'll be comedies and whatnot. And we need that. We need different things. Horror says a social commentary. Comedy is basically, in a way, truth telling. Like, even if you think about Shakespeare, how he uses the, you know, the jesters and stuff, they tell the truth. The Joker always tells, you know, the Joker guy always tells the truth right to the faces of people involved. So comedy does that. Comedy makes fun of us because it's telling us that's how silly you are. You know, if you don't understand that, that's fine. You laugh and you move on. But if you understand that, it changes you. You have a shift in yourself as well. So going back to your question, focus on human condition. Focus on the situations that seem to be silly. Use them as social commentaries for the story and see where it goes. Like, honestly, we are talking about it here and there. So we never know. Maybe, I don't know, maybe it might happen. Maybe we'll have a toilet paper battle in the next series.
If we wrote this story in the past 9 months instead of a few years back, I would have wanted one of the characters to be an anti-masker, because it would be funny. Just have a character, despite all logic and seeing rabid children running into the streets and seeing the chaos and just going, nope, not happening. Nope, false news isn't real. Because it's like, that's like one of the big truth stranger than fiction things. But yeah, it's like, I by happenstance, I was in the cinema when stuff was really going down, when everything went into lockdown. And we knew it was starting to happen. We had self-instigated, just started to say, we're going to limit how many people are going to come in here. We're going to do masks. We're going to do whatever. We just started doing that, like a lot of small businesses did. But then the day we all closed down, I've never felt more like I was in a horror movie. Like, it was crazy. So I was sitting in the box office, working on my laptop, as I often do, kind of multitasking, looking outside, never being more angry at someone than seeing like this lady walk by just with an armful of toilet paper, just with like a comical amount of toilet paper. And then just swapping emails with a couple of my partners from the cinema and being like, one of them said, I think we got to close down now, like right now. And we closed down halfway through the day. So like the people came out of the matinee and we said, we're closed. We canceled that night show. And then I was there by myself at the time, kind of finishing stuff up because the candy bar person had gone home. And it got really emotional because I had to like change the marquee and say, we're closed. And I had to like take down all these signs and change the answer message. And, you know, any small business is like barely getting by at the best of times. And I just got hit. It's my biggest nerd story around this is that I got hit with a quote from Return of the Jedi when Han Solo thinks he's not going to see the Millennium Falcon again. And I swear to God, I'm not even like trying to be flip about it. In my brain, I got the quote of, I don't think I'm going to see her again. And there was just this sense that we're going to close down and all these small businesses are going to go away. And it's stuff like that, that I'm sure will inspire character points and will inspire plot points here and there in our hopeful sequel to this world. Cause you can't help it. You can't like I'm sure every major thing like that has, but yeah, like everybody now has felt like they've been in a horror movie these past couple months. And so, yeah, that's going to affect things for sure. Like, no question.
Wow. Dude, guys, thank you for sharing. Really. Yeah. Are you still closed still, Josh?
No, we've been lucky. So, how it worked in Ottawa and Ontario kind of. So we were closed down from March to July. And if you ever want like a silver lining, feel good about humanity story, it's how small businesses have been helped during this time. So we did a number of things, whether it be sell off messages on the marquee. We sold off name tags on the seats, put up a plaque, all that kind of stuff. We sold out of our seats. All 325 seats got sold with a little name tag for $150. So that was a nice chunk of money. We were selling like happy birthday messages on the marquee, just any kind of little pivot we could do to make a couple more dollars. And leading into it, we were doing very well. We had Parasite for 17 weeks. Our record before that was 8 weeks for a movie. So we were getting like 200 people a night for Parasite. We might have had Parasite for 24 weeks. So we had a nice little nest egg going, but a number of businesses in our neighborhood, like we have this great little pinball bar across the street called House of Targ. So they sold merch and they sold takeout pierogies. We have a really great bookstore across the street called Black Squirrel Books. And they did takeout books, essentially, like come up to the door and you can get books and stuff like that. So we got through. Then we came back for a little bit, closed down for another month. And now we've been back for another few weeks and we're hanging in there. Currently in Ottawa, none of the multiplexes are open. So we're it. So that's kind of, you know, you don't want to take advantage of things, but it's a weird position to be in right now where we're the only cinema in town. We can only have 50 people in at a time, but that's not too bad for us. So we're just hanging in there. Like we're positive. We're doing okay. We can survive this for a little while. But it's as weird as it is for everybody, no matter your line of work. So it's, but yeah, we're hanging in there.
Awesome. I'm happy to hear that, man. Just, and I apologize to you both on going on this tangent, but it's, I think with the theme of, you know, horror and just the world and comics, popular culture, you know, it all kind of bleeds together. Again, the Damned Cursed Children looks amazing. Robin threw down, and just hearing the love from both of you guys on how this project came together, the collaboration, and just the old school love for just the covers, it just has me smiling. I'm looking at, you know, issue one right now, and having read, you know, issue one, and then checking out the thank you, Howard, for the preview on issue two. This just looks amazing. I can't wait to see the rest of the series. Just amazing work you guys have put together. I would love to see how you guys will collaborate on a maybe not even a horror story in the future down the line, if you guys do something together again, or if we get a part two of this, if there's a Dawn of the Dead, you know, so this is your Night of the Living Dead, or your, like you said, this is all occurs in one day, but if there's a sequel And interesting to hear that there was somewhat of a talk that Howard kind of gave up. So I appreciate that. But let's check out issue one, or the first five issues of Damn Cursed Children from Source Porn Press. Just looks brilliant. And just, again, the love just sounds amazing. Thank you both for sharing all of that great information. You guys, I'm a new fan. Definitely. I can, because I can see the love. You guys put your heart into it. And you guys appreciate the medium, so definitely. But before I let you guys go, this is the Nerds of Color, and if y'all have been tracking with my interviews, I like to check y'all on your nerddom. So I do a nerd check. I kind of see already Howard has a little bit of his nerddom behind him. Josh, I can't tell too much in your place at the moment.
But, I can show off some nerd stuff pretty easy.
if you were tasked to do a TEDx, a nerd talk on something, it doesn't have to be popular culture or like Star Wars or sci-fi or comics. If there's, it could just be, you know, I'm the most nerd on the Ramones. You, like you said, you were wearing a Ramones shirt at San Diego Comic-Con. Mm-hmm. What could you get of a TEDx nerd style talk on, and no one could challenge you? Whoever wants to go first, what is your supreme nerddom on?
Well, I got an idea. I've got forever. I thought if I ever, because university always has those weird courses, you know, like you can.
You thought of a TEDx talk?
Oh, I got one. Yeah. No, I've always been fascinated how Superman and Batman were created in the same universe, but kind of before shared universe was a thing. Like they were created before, you know, like when teams started happening, that's kind of like, you know, when the Justice League happened, when Avengers and Fantastic Four happened and it was all in Manhattan. Like that's when, before it was a mess, you know, like the pre-crisis world, it was just stories, which is fine. It was just stories. But the fact that Batman and Superman were created by two different groups of people who didn't meet, that it happened at the same publisher. And especially when you look at like the modern kind of retcon Batman and Superman, where Superman is an alien who's orphaned, who comes to Earth, is raised in a, you know, in a fictional like Kansas type place by farmers, and grows up hiding who he really is and becomes a reporter, and then becomes a superhero who doesn't wear a mask, is out in the daylight all the time and is colorful, like red and blue. Then you got the other guy who is an orphan and then is rich and is raised by his butler, one in a Manhattan type sky rise, or in like a Wayne mansion, and one in a farmhouse. And then in modern times, they get written as like best friends, one in a mask, one without a mask, one who has a sidekick, one who traditionally didn't have a sidekick, one who has like a father figure, one who, depending on when, has a mother and father figure. And they're complete opposite, and they work so well together, and they weren't created for that. And that the whole thing of people say that Batman is the real character and Bruce is the secret identity. And then on Superman, it's Clark is the real guy and Superman is a secret identity. And I'm fascinated by that, and that more writers keep piling on that, and like whether it be Mark Waid or Grant Morrison, everybody has done all these great stories like that. And I can't get over the one in a billion chance that Batman wasn't bought by Marvel Comics or something. Like it's just amazing. So that's my TED talk. I could write a good thesis on Batman and Superman. I love that.
Wow. I never knew that you had a TED talk.
This is I'm awesome. Ready. I'm ready to go.
I'm still like, what? Really? This is awesome. Oh man. Oh, this is like, that's a good question for me, because anyone who knows me knows that I like a lot of different things, but I don't like go super deep in anything. I guess I don't know. Do I? Now I'm questioning it. Now you're making question my nerddom. But because I collect everything from, like, I love giant robots. If you don't know, you can see it because of reflection. Like, this is like one of my Hong Kong buys. I think it's like 13 inches, Christ, from Guy King. That's back when I was a kid. Like, they used to broadcast it in English on the big, you know, giant TV box, you know, the old school TV, Channel 3 Global, after school. I would actually run home from school to catch it every day. So I watched that growing up. So I like the giant robot stuff. So I could probably talk about that. But that'll be all from memory. So I probably, it's like anything you remember when you're a kid, it's always better in your memory. But when you watch it, and I tried watching some of the episodes, I'm like, wow, this is actually really slow and kind of repetitive. But the memories is always much better. So I could probably talk about that a bit. I'm just wondering, what can I talk about? Correct.
Just knowing your daughter's name, you have to be a Lord of the Rings fan, right?
Oh my God. Yeah, that's bad. Yeah, I am. So now you bring that up. So my daughter's name, my eldest daughter's, I have two daughters. My eldest daughter's name is Arwen. And like true fashion as an idiot, we didn't name her a kid until after she was born. So we were literally watching Lord of the Rings DVD box set, the extended version, and watched all the extra DVDs as well. And I literally remember turning to my wife, I'm like, we should name her Arwen. Yeah, I think that's what we should name her. And my wife's like, she didn't say no. That's the best part. She most wives would be like, no, that's too geeky. She's like, okay, we should change the spelling. I'm like, sure. And so it's spelt differently, and that's where it came from. But because of that, became kind of a bit of a nerd for Lord of the Rings because I've got quite a bit of stuff. I mean, like we traveled. Yeah, we did actually. We traveled to New Zealand once upon a time, and we're like looking at, you know, where they film the things. I didn't get to Weta Studios, but I have a Weta Studios story there. But I held some of the swords. I won't say from where and from who because I'll get in trouble. But I held some of some props that were used. That was fun. And they were really freaking like real swords. They're heavy. Like I was afraid that I was going to drop it and hurt myself. Like I'm a big guy. I'm a skinny guy. So I was like, geez. So yeah, I guess that's, I'm pretty nerd onto that too. Wow, that's a good question. Maybe Robotech, possibly. Thinking robots too. I keep thinking robots for some reason right now. I think I'll probably do this 1970 robots, maybe one talk. I could talk about the character I created in the Iron Man book, which is also based on my eldest daughter. I might have, do I have that here? Oh yeah, I did. Okay, let me see. So let's see. So this is the book I did for Marvel in Hong Kong Disneyland, where I created a new character. So I can nerd out about her because I made her. So this is another character. I don't know if you guys can see. Okay, so can somebody talk to me? Can you guys see this, or am I showing it?
Yeah,
super cool.
Good.
I want that action figure. I want that. I want that Funko. I want merchandise.
Me too. So I created that character for a story that was a project between Marvel and Hong Kong Disneyland, and named it after my daughter. So I can definitely nerd out on that because I went too far with the backstory. Definitely too far. So I can nerd out on that for sure. Oh no, man, this is a good question. I'm like turning around looking at my stuff. I have a lot of weird stuff, man. I have anything from giant robots to pickle. I have a Pickle Rick up there as well. Jesus Christ, what else do I have up? So I don't remember Final Fantasy VII. I've been these are unopened crap. This is like this is when you know you have a problem, when you have all this shit as unopened and untouched and not played with. What else do I have here? I have Robotech stuff, which is awesome. The Robotech stuff is awesome, by the way. And this is actually okay, I'd be very careful. This is actually something I got from Japan. Don't worry about that.
Oh, shit.
Actually, no, that's all right. That's the stuff I have out usually are like stuff I have reprints and whatnot. But I have two things I could probably nerd out about. One is this.
Okay, X-Wing.
This is an old school.
Yeah.
I got this from a farmer. No joke. I was on a farm, but let me see if I can grab this out real careful. I was in Japan 1 year. I was going to a temple. So along the way to the temple, these big temples, usually there's like little shops and stuff along the way. And yeah, they usually sell things that are for the temple or tourists. Then I saw this. I don't know if you guys can see that.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, I got it.
Good?
Yeah.
So this is basically a set. It's supposed to be a set of three. I only have one of them because the guy only has one. It's actually for old school cell phones. So cell phones used to look like this, guys, believe it or not, with buttons. Are you guys freaking out, you young guys?
Holder.
Real buttons, yeah. So if you don't know what this is Lupin the Third. You actually read it, right? That's Lupin the Third.
Yeah.
So if you guys, it's on Netflix. Watch it. it's not done, not created by, but the animation was done by Studio Ghibli. So I can nerd out about that film like you wouldn't believe, because I played that game on Chuck E. Cheese. It was called Cliffhanger. I don't know why they renamed it. It was called Cliffhanger, and I spent too much money dying in that game. I never ever finished it. I remember downloading that damn thing on PC. I still couldn't finish it until I got the cheats, and I was like, I finished it, and I was like, so not worth it. I was so angry at myself, like, why can't I do this when I was a kid? But I can nerd out on that for sure. That was a great film. So as I said, I have a lot of different things. So that the anime stuff that I like. I mean, I can nerd out a lot of different things. So it depends on who's in the room, what we're talking about. I can go to a certain length and talk about something. You know, like Transformers. Like, oh shit! I was gonna break this out because I couldn't find my headset, so I was gonna break this out. So this was a birthday gift one day.
Oh,
from
shit.
Somebody.
No.
For you. Again, this is unopened too. So this is actual functioning headphones.
That's the Frenzy coolest Rumble. Thing I've ever seen.
Yeah.
It's a working Transformer.
Hell yeah.
That's pretty, awesome. Pretty badass, right?
Dude.
So I didn't open this yet.
I got to open up another tab on my computer while I got to look that up.
The closest thing I have to that is I have a USB key that's an actual Transformer of Ravage. That's the closest thing I have to that.
So the coolest thing is this. It's actually not Hasbro, but from the old school. The original. Right. So that was I didn't open it yet, but I was going because I couldn't find my headphones. And I was like looking at it. I'm like, should I open this? I need to do this. And then all I hear from my wife's like, there's no mic on it. I'm like, yeah, that's a good reason why I shouldn't open this. Right. I should open this. But I was like going to open it. But what else can I nerd about? I think that's about it. I mean, let me think here. I have a dual story. So, giant robots. So this is a thing I did for Bandai and Threezero.
Okay.
Here we go. Yeah. So this was a project for a toy called Full Metal Ghost. The guy who created that, his name is Kuno. Actually, you can see his name here. Kuno. Or I don't know where I can. Are you guys seeing this?
Yep.
So,
yeah.
Kuno Okawara.
Right. So if people were like, who the hell is that? Well, you look at Gundam. Mobile Suit. He's the guy who designed all the Gundams. He also did all the enemy vehicles for Gatchaman, aka Battle Planets, and his list of creds goes on and on. So when they asked me to do the story development for his toy, I was like, yes, please. Been nerd on there. So, you know, we did a comic for it as well, for a promo comic.
Awesome.
So I can totally nerd out on this because I know the entire story because I created it. And he was super cool because he literally let me do what the heck I wanted with some interjections of characters that he wanted to see. And then he would throw me hand sketches, which I shared on he shared online now. But at that time, no one knew about it except for Bandai's art director, the toy design guys, and me. And I was like, he would just send it. It's like, oh my God, if I share this online, that'd be so cool, but I can't. So I can nerd out on that forever because there was so much weirdness in that room of meetings. We talked about the robots because when I wasn't even getting the job yet. I mean, the story for the job was actually hilarious because the owner of Threezero, Kim Fung, I love that guy. He's awesome. He's an awesome guy. He called me up one day when I was in Hong Kong and said to come over and hang out. He does this all the time. He's like, hey, come over and hang out at my studio. Look at what we got. And we show me like the new prototypes and stuff, which I can't. And then he knows I won't show it to anyone, but God, I would like to steal them all. seriously. So I go in this room and I go in dressed like him. This is when he had his original place, which was like a factory place. So it's really hot. It's like Hong Kong in the summer is horrible. It's like you're like literally just like Niagara Falls, wherever you walk. So I'm like t-shirt, shorts, and sandals. I walk in, I'm like, hey, how's it going? It's like, hey, we're having a meeting. I'm like, oh, okay. No, you're part of it. I say, what? So I walk in the room, and then Bandai guys are in suits. And he's just the same way I am, which is good. I'm like, what's this about? Mariah, I said, we want to work together on something? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, this is it. So it was a Bandai guys asking me about if I wanted to work with everyone on this project, and they showed me prototypes and asked me if I had ideas for a giant robot story right there. So I had to like pull my nerd hat on tight. I'm like, okay, I have to make up an entire storyline right now for a job that I really, really want. And I started telling them and what I thought was a good idea for a story. Then they questioned my nerddom. This is the best part. It's like, why do you think you can write this? Like literally after I actually showed that I could do it, and I didn't share the end because I really wanted the job. I had an ending though. And I'm like, why? Because Grandizer, Guy King, Voltron, I can go on and on. It's like, do you know these properties? Gotcha, man. Yeah, I watched this growing up. This was my I thought these were normal cartoons growing up. I watched them in English. And the Gotcha Man, they edited all the violence. By the way, Battle Plan is super violent when you watch the original ones. It's crazy. So I basically nerded out on like 1970s robots, 60s, 70s robots at them. And they're like, oh, so you know about that, our culture about that. Like, I think most of North Americans, my age group, love it because I have this crap. If you have some, I would buy them, right? That's how it went. And then, they went from there to what I would understand, how I would translate his designs into a story that would be fitting for nerds like me, which was like, that's easy because I know how to feed into that because I've been dreaming about this since I was like 9, so no problem. So that was a weird challenge and way I got the job because I sat down and watched cartoons every day, I got this job, which is really weird. What else did I have from there? So I don't think I have anything else from there. I mean, that was just the book from there. So it was crazy I got that job. So I can nerd out about that for sure. What else can I nerd out about? Seriously. Oh, yes, this. So I didn't open this yet either. So I know you guys have probably seen this one. This is from
That's super cool.
Bandai.
Yeah.
So this is like the redesigned or reimagined Star Wars figures, right?
Oh yeah.
So from Bandai. Here we go, Bandai.
Yeah.
So I opened the box and stuff like that, but they had these there before it came out. This is like way back in the day. So before it came out, they had them at the offices there, and like I know a bit because when you write, you know a bit about stuff. So this is like still in the plastic stuff. So I'm not going to take it out. Sorry. This is as far as I'm going to go. So I saw these figures there on their table. God damn, I should have stole one. And I noticed the armor. I was like, and I was joking. I'm this guy who would go in meetings with Bandai with guys in suits and like, so why does this guy have nipples on his armor? And they were like shocked. What do you mean? And they literally stop the meeting and start studying the figure. Like, I know, because if you see, it's kind of people are laughing at it. If you study the samurai, their armor and the meepos and stuff, it's actually, they do certain designs for protection. So one of it's the Buddha. So the ones with the nipples and stuff is actually the Buddha for them to protect them in battle. For some reason, nobody here who is from Japan figured it out. So they literally stopped the meeting. They talked about it, and he actually messaged the guy who designed it to ask him what's going on with the prototype. Wow. And I'm like, I'm so sorry. I know why, and I explain it. It's like, and the guy, like, he's like messaging back and trying to explain it, and they were all laughing. And I was like, I did not mean. I was literally a joke. I am so sorry. I'm so bad. And then because of that, I got into the art director's office. And he had, let me see if I can nerd out. So you know who this guy is?
Oh yeah.
I hope.
Oh yeah.
So he had this giant bike about this big. So it was about 13 inches long. Mm-hmm. So he had his bike there. It was like nice. I'm like, wow, that's a really cool toy you got there. Is that yours? It's like, yep. It's the first toy ever made from Akira. First one ever made. I'm like, oh, I'm gonna steal that. I literally told him I'm gonna steal that before the end of the day. I'm gonna run out. I'm gonna steal it. And that's it. And it's like he takes it. He drops it in my hand. It's freaking heavy. And I'm like, ooh, you want me to steal it? It's like, don't steal it. I'm like, okay. And it's like, ask me who designed. He literally asked me who designed it. I'm like, who designed it? I did. I'm like, oh shit. So the art director is telling me he designed it. He talked to Otomo and he told me all these stories that I can't share because it's like, you know, NDA and stuff, I guess. But I don't want to get in trouble. So he shared me all these crazy stories about the guy. I'm like, her holding this thing. I'm like, this is the first you know, toy ever made. This is like a prototype. Like, yep. Now I really want to steal this. and I gave it back to him. But I was like, oh, this is crazy. So I can nerd out about stuff like that. I know it's like kind of weird. So like these little tiny snippets of stories of how things came to be from people's childhoods and stuff. I mean, we've witnessed two little things that I can and cannot share that people do ask all the time, like the Disney stuff. Like I got to walk in the back lots and stuff of Hong Kong Disneyland, which is, it's crazy. It's like you're taking those shortcuts that people, you know, the mythical shortcuts and passing the costuming and stuff, which is like, they think it's like one floor, but there's like so many. I can't even talk about it because I might get in trouble. There's a lot of things happening there. It's crazy. Going to a meeting in Disneyland is like the best, by the way. If you're a nerd and you somehow, some reason, go to Disneyland for a meeting, do it. Don't say I'll do it. You know, if when things get back to normal, don't say I'll do it remote. You fly your ass there and do it. Because everything's designed so well. Like I'm walking past like life-size statues of actors and characters, whatnot. And then you have like little windows the shape of Mickey Mouse's head. And like, this is such a nerd on. I can't take photos because it's going to be professional. Like I'm literally keeping my hands in my pockets so I don't end up taking photos and selfies as I walk in.
I feel that.
It's absolutely madness. So it's like things like that where I'm like, people who are in the know, we could talk about it and then nerd out about that. It's crazy. I don't know. What else can I talk about?
You've covered
it. I'm trying to figure out, I guess.
Yeah.
But, you know, I says a little bit of everything from toys, comics, games, you know. I can nerd out a bit of anything, but I don't have a specialty. I feel kind of a jack of all trades of nerding, I guess, would be the best.
You are a super nerd. We've covered that. You are awesome, Howard. You totally nerded out. I appreciate that. And Josh, thank you as well. I do that as a segue as we leave out because, you know, hey, if there's a DC Comics editor listening, we got Josh over here that's ready to tell that Batman and Superman story. And since you, Howard, have already done kind of like a big robot, when you mentioned Lord of the Rings and your daughter having that, if we could get a Tolkien person who wants to put together, hey, a Lord of the Rings set universe piece that Howard can kind of touch, you know, hey, let's do that. And so as we sign off, let's, Josh, why don't you lead with your socials and how they can follow and hit you up online. Again, signing off, we want you guys to definitely pick up Damned Cursed Children. As you can see, their love for the story and how it came together and the brilliant work from Robin Simon Ng on this. It's fantastic. But Josh, tell them how they can check you out online and also what they feel after they read it, how they can hit you up and they can tell you what they thought of the story.
Yeah, on Facebook, just Josh Stafford, you can find me. My icon is Damien and Bat Cow, so easy to find. I'm kind of undercover as Mayfair Theatre on Twitter, which is just at Mayfair Theatre. And we also host a weekly Mayfair Theatre podcast that we're about to hit 300 episodes on. And you can find that on all the places you find podcasts and on Instagram, which I don't use as much as I should, but it's BatTurtle_Mayfair, and that's where I'm on Instagram.
Awesome.
And for me, if you want to find out where I am on social media, you just go to my blog because I have them all listed there. So if you go to howard-wong.blogspot.com, you will find every single social media feed that I have. And if you want to tell us good things or bad things about Damned Cursed Children,
only good. I only want to hear good things.
Yeah. So only good things for Josh. I'll take both. I take critiques, both good and bad. I'm sort of a neutral person, I guess, amongst us. So if you go to Facebook and you hit up the Source Point Press fan page, feel free to drop us a note there, and we will read it and get back to you as soon as we can.
Awesome. Love it, guys. Thank you so much. So I'll have some, as you all can see that are watching this, I'll have some of the links on the screen right now, but look in the description below. I'll have all of their links there for you guys. So you can just click on that after you're done watching this, and you can shoot them a follow and hopefully order your next issue of Source Point Press's Damn Cursed Children, and also bug them for, hey, we want a sequel and all of that. So I know these guys, like we said, they already have kind of a rough idea on what they want to do, but gentlemen, truly a pleasure. I see the love through this conversation, and really appreciate the stories that went along with it. It kind of made me feel like I was at a convention again, and hearing, you know, like we started off with the con stories and then the stories behind it. That's what, again, I went off on a tangent because this has been a wild year. And for me doing these interviews, I usually do these in person. This is another changing thing for me, having to do this, you know, through the Zoom world now that we're living in. So to hear this information from you guys is truly a pleasure. And I can't thank you enough. Thank you for coming on. Make sure you guys shoot them a follow. I am Kuya P. You can follow me at Strange Since 1977 and at Temple Far East. That's Twitter and IG. Here at the Nerds of Color, that's at the Nerds of Color everything. And as well as my bigger pop culture sphere, which is at the NRW or at Nerd Release Wednesday, because that is Nerds Ruled World. We cover everything. We do a lot of reviews on movies, TVs, currently The Mandalorian, Utopia. Great shows that you should check out on your streaming services. But again, thank you, gentlemen. Thank you for watching. This is the NOC, Nerds of Color, and I'll be back again with another NOC exclusive.